Hello and welcome to 7 Days of Science. We've got a very special guest. Starting off the news this week, a study published in the Journal of High Energy Physics has taken a look at the relative mystery of what happens to the information taken in by a black hole after it evaporates. In accordance with the theories that Stephen Hawking drew up in the 70s, black holes emit radiation, slowly shrinking the black hole until it completely disappears. This evaporation has a few questions associated with it, namely, where does all the information that fell into the black hole go? Recently, scientists have tried answering this by looking at black holes as wormholes for this information, connecting the interior of the black hole to the radiation it emits. This study looked at designing a replica for such a wormhole, but this doesn't come close to answering all the questions of how this might work, but it has pointed us to some of the right ones. As always, links in the description if you want to read more about this. In other news, scientists have put together a 9-step plan to bring the Tasmanian tiger, a carnivorous marsupial, back from extinction. It was declared extinct in 1982 due to human activities such as mass farming, and there has been a concerted effort to looking at ways to bring it back. The good news is that 2 of these 9 steps have already been completed, and now with extra funding, researchers in Australia hope that one day they can bring back the Tasmanian tiger to its relatively unchanged habitat. This will take time though, with the team estimating that these steps alone would take around a decade or more. But the process as a whole and what is learned along the way will be a massive step forward in terms of marsupial conservation. And now over to Neb.
Thanks, Doug. Well, first in the news this week is another new early thyreophoran, the grouping that includes stegosaurs and ankylosaurs, from the early Jurassic of China. Named Yuxisaurus kopchicki, I'm not even going to pretend I said that correctly, it's a very basal early diverging member of the group that is known from an associated but partial skeleton. It has a robust body that sort of looks similar to more derived stegosaurs and ankylosaurs, but other characteristics in fact place it very close to the base of the group. And its discovery at this time in the early Jurassic indicates how fast these dinosaurs spread and diversified after they first appeared. The very distinctive armour it displays also suggests a previously underappreciated diversity in terms of thyreophoran morphology early on in their evolution. Next up is our second new dinosaur of the week, yet another alvarezsaurid, but this time from Uzbekistan. Named Jara Onyx Eski, again, these names are just trying to make me look like an idiot trying to say them, I swear. It's based on some disassociated but pretty well preserved bones from the body. Various anatomical features of these bones indicate its uniqueness compared to other alvarezsaurids, and a phylogenetic analysis of the dinosaur found it to be the geologically oldest member of the alvarezsaurid subgroup Parvicursorinae. Oh, and another bit of paleontology news that we should have covered last week but forgot to, was the naming of a new species of vampyropod, after Joe Biden for some reason. Psilopsimapodi bideni. This fossil is actually a really fascinating discovery, coming from the Carboniferous period 328 million years ago. Not only does it push back the fossil record of vampyropods, a related group to modern octopuses and vampire squid, but it's also the only known member of this group to retain 10 arms, with all other known examples having 8 arms, informing paleontologists about how these animals lost their other 2 arms during their evolution. And finally for this week's paleontology news is the naming and description of a new saber-toothed mammal, Diego Aulurus van Valkenburghi. It's a member of the Machairoidinae group, early to mid-Eocene aged animals that were the first mammals to evolve saber teeth, long before the famous saber-toothed cats. An almost complete lower jawbone was discovered in Southern California and has been identified as this new genus and species, and is actually now the youngest Machairoidine so far known to science. Not only that, but since it differs so much from the only other member of this group that lived at around the same time, it shows for the first time that multiple lineages of these mammals existed. It also extends the geological record of Machairoidines forward in time, suggesting that they actually went extinct around the time of the mid to late Eocene faunal turnover in North America. Well, that's it for this week. Back to Doug in the studio.
Thank you, Ben. Well, that's it for this week's 7 Days of Science. I do hope you enjoyed, and as always, we'll see you on Friday.